All right, praise the Lord, everybody. We are grateful to be back one more wonderful evening here in Bible study. I hope and pray everybody's doing well out there, and hope you had an awesome day today. And we pray that the Lord is blessing you real good. Amen. We pray by the end of this Bible study, you will be blessed. Amen. By His Word. God's Word always blesses our soul, always blesses you, as we encourage you to stay in it, read it. Bible tells us to study it. Amen. That we can be approved by Almighty God. We don't have to be ashamed. Again today on that great day. And so we encourage you to continue to read your Bibles daily. Amen. Don't just wait for these Bible studies, but do it the daily devotion. We encourage you, try to get one or two chapters in a day. Try to get one or two chapters in a day at the minimum. Amen. And so we encourage you to stay in God's Word. It's just like eating natural food. We eat the spiritual food from Almighty God. Amen. So we've been covering the 66 books in 52 weeks, which is 1 year. And so we are now in the Gospel of John, the fourth of the four Gospels, again, written by John. And so we mentioned how that God, again, used these men to divinely inspire the Word of God, written divinely by them, again, through Holy Spirit, to write the accounts in which Jesus had done here in the four Gospels. And so these cover the accounts from various perspectives from each four of these men. And so we are covering John today. John was considered a beloved disciple. He was considered loved by Jesus. You may find that written from time to time throughout it. And he betrays Jesus as the Messiah. As you go back and read it, as we go through some of them, he's going to continue to show that he is the Messiah, the Christ. And so, again, it was kind of his theme, running theme. One other thing was the Son of Man. Or the Son of God, and various ones, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, each have their own portrayal of what they were trying to show Christ as. Amen. And so John showed him again today as really the Messiah here. And so he was a close eyewitness. He was a close eyewitness, and he spent many of the days and many of the nights with Christ, no doubt. And so great, mighty, mighty works again today. We're going to cover here in a minute. I want to open up again in John chapter 20. We'll go to the end. I want to go to the end. John chapter 20 verse 31, and this is kind of a summarization of what this all about. John 20 verse 31, it says here, "But these are written that ye might believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing ye might have a life through his name." So John kind of summarizes it there. Again, these writings, these things that are written, we'll come back to that in a little bit, but these things that were written were that we can believe on him, to believe on him and know that he is God. And so chapters one, he kind of gives an introduction to who Jesus is. Again, it really portrays it, hammers it home of who Christ is. And so we covered it, I believe, this Sunday night, from this chapters 1 through 14. We covered it of how it shows that Christ was eternal. It's going to also show that he was there in the beginning, and how he is God, and again today he always will be God. And so he became flesh. So we're going to look at this real quickly. We'll run through it. We covered it Sunday night. Go back and listen to the message, but I'm going to read it again. The Bible says in verse 1, John 1:1, he said, "In the beginning was the Word." And he says, "And the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God, and all things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made." And so the Word we covered this Sunday night, about the Word of God. If you missed Sunday night service, the word was there in the beginning. And it also said it was with God, and also say it was God, as you see here. The Bible says, "And all things were made by him," in verse 3 again. Verse 4, it says, "In him was life." In who? The Word. "And the Word was life, and life was the light of men, and the light shineth in darkness, and the darkness comprehended not," as we covered our day. The darkness cannot receive it into your mind. You open up your heart and your mind, you will never, ever be able to receive the Word of God truly. You may understand a little bit the concept of it, but to really let it live and breathe in you and abide in you and become a part of you, you're going to have to open up your eyes and open up your heart and be willing to come out of darkness into the marvelous light of Almighty God. Like the Bible says, "And the light shineth in darkness, and the darkness coming in." 9, verse 6, he says, "And there was a man sent from God whose name was John." It's not John the writer here, but it's John the Baptist. The Bible says, "And the same was for a witness, to bear witness of the light, that all men through him might believe." And so he was not that light, but I was sent to bear witness of the light. Number 90 says, and that was the true light, which lighteth every man that cometh into the world. And so John came to preach and to teach again today and be the forerunner and introduce the world to Jesus. He says that all men can be saved and have this glorious life. Number 10, he goes on. He said he was in the world and the world was made by him and the world knew him not. So that again, he came, he given a summarization of everything that would take place when Jesus would come. He came into the world, but they refused to hear him. He says he came into his own and his own received him not. So he came to the Jewish people. He came to fulfill the laws, again, to fulfill the prophecy, I should say, of Abraham. Again, when he told him out of him was going to raise up a mighty nation, and through his lineage, he would use them to no doubt reach the world. And so, again, he came into his own, the Jewish people, but they rejected him. And many still do to this day. Many still do to this day. They are waiting for the Messiah, but he's already come. Nearly 2,000 years ago. The Bible goes on and says here, and he came, 12 verse 12, but he says, as the many as received him, to them gave he power to become sons of God. And went on and says, even to them that believe on his name. And so as many as will believe on him, they received and they were empowered. Salvation empowers you. The Holy Spirit will empower you to where now you are a son of God. You can overcome the enemy. You can overcome the world. And that's what Jesus came to do. And in verses 13, he says, which were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but the will of God. This is God's plan for our lives. No longer the world, we want to do our own thing, but let us do the work of God. Verse 14, he went on and says, and the word was made flesh. So remember back in the beginning, he says, in the beginning was the word. And so now he declares that the word became flesh. Who's the word? The Bible tells us it's Jesus. He says, dwelt among us. And so he dwelt among you. He came and took on the flesh, the form of man through the virgin birth. And see, John does not cover the virgin birth. John doesn't cover that part of it. He jumps right into his ministry. And unlike Luke and Matthew and even Mark cover a little bit about the birth of Christ. John does not cover it at all. He jumps right into the ministry. That's why I say each one has a different perspective. And so John got right down to the nitty gritty of his ministry. And so it says here he became flesh through the virgin birth. He became flesh. And so we put it together. It's through the virgin birth. And the Bible says that we beheld his glory, and the glory that was the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. And so there it is. There it is. Again, how that the Lord, again, John gave an introduction. He gave an introduction to that. And so also in John chapter 1, he also shows us, and so back to what I want to give this also, Elohim. So we believe in the Trinity. We believe in Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Again, so what we call Elohim. Elohim is the concept of it. We see God many times. Some people may think of him being just the Father, but again, when he says Elohim, it's referring to Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Remember in the book of Genesis, he says, let us make man in our image. Let us make man in our image. The Bible says God said, let us make man. So you can see how that words, again, you got to really, if you study out those words and look up the Greek and Hebrew of those words. So Elohim there, it falls into that Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And so this was really a account showing Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Again, today, and so that was what that's all about. And also in John, John also covers some titles given. All in chapter 1, he gave some titles to Christ. Let's look at John 1:29. The Bible says, these are some of the titles of Christ. The Bible says, in the day John, the next day, John seeth Jesus coming unto him and saith, behold, the Lamb of God. So there's a title of Jesus, the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sins of the world. So that's one of the titles. He's going to give you seven titles here in the latter part of the first chapter. He called him the Lamb of God. The Lamb of God, what did he come to do? Take away the sins of the world. We talked about the other day about how, again, we needed a lamb. God had orchestrated innocent blood be shed for the sins of man. And so the ultimate innocent blood was through Jesus Christ. And so we find that's where they came from, about how the Lamb of God was taketh away the sins of the world. Let me share this out real quickly. Blood
was through Jesus.
Hold on, folks. I want to share this out on my page. I didn't share that to my friends and my loved ones, so they can get the video as well. All right, so verse 34. I give you 34. Verse 134, the Bible says another title of Christ. He says, I saw and bear record that this is the what? Son of God. So again, Again, the writer shows he is the Son of God. So first he was the Lamb of God. He's also declaring he's the Son of God. Verse 36 talks about, and looking upon Jesus as he walked, he saith, behold, the Lamb of God. There it is again. Verse 41, the Bible says, he findeth his own brother Simon and said unto him, we have found the Messiah. So again, another title for the Christ, the Messiah, the Savior. The Bible goes come on and say in verse, the rest of the verse, he says, which is being interpreted the Christ. You see that? Which is being interpreted the Christ. So there's two titles there, Messiah and Christ. Verse 49 talks about Nathanael answered and said unto him, Rabbi. Rabbi means teacher. So he was also titled a teacher. He says, and thou art the Son of God. That is again, the Son of God. And one more title, the King of Israel. So Nathanael declared him as the King of Israel. They was going to start some trouble. They're going to start some trouble, call him the King of Israel. And the Bible goes on. Again, in another place, he calls him the Son of Man. The Son of Man. But he was verse 51. I don't know if I gave it to you, but in verse 51, he calls him the Son of Man. The Son of Man. All right, chapters 2 through 10 covers miracles. Miracles covers miracles of Jesus. We know we serve a miracle working God. We have miracles, no doubt. Continue to pray for one another. Again, pray for your loved ones. When you need a miracle, call on God. But God is a miracle working God. He's able to do miracles. And so we're going to find the miracles in which he had done really seven profound miracles that stand out. And so John began to write these miracles out. Really, it stood out in a mighty way. One was water into wine. Water into wine. Also, again, some other times. And so I want to bring this up about every time there was a miracle, there was also going to be some confrontation or some type of debate or something that the religious crowd was hanging around, lurking around, looking to find fault with Jesus. And so many times we say it again, when God is ready to bless your life, when God is about to bless your life, be ready for confrontation. When God is ready to bless your life, be ready for confrontation. So every time Jesus did a miracle, there was always the Pharisees and Sadducees lurking in the back. Looking to find fault with something that should have been a joyous celebration. So we also find in chapter 2 where Jesus went through and whipped the temple, went through with the whip and broke up the temple, broke up the tables and money changers, and told him it should be called a house of prayer. And so we find various times which Jesus from 2 to 10 would do various miracles and find controversy along the way. And really was building up the case to where he would be crucified. Let's go to John chapter 3. John chapter 3 is probably the one of the most famous chapters in John and really in the Bible. Probably one of the most famous quoted verses in the Bible is found in John 3. So let's look at something. It was a famous encounter with a man named Nicodemus. Nicodemus was a ruler of the Jews, the Bible says, and he had saw all of these things that was going on. He's gotten rumors and he was hearing things, and so he got curious. He wasn't ready to fight against these like his peers. He said, you know, I'm gonna come to find out what this is all about. So the Bible says he came to him by night. In the night, he came up, sneaked up to him, and was talking with him one-on-one, because if he had found out, people would have found out he was talking with Jesus, he probably would have been banned and disbanded and thrown out the group, whatever case may be. But he came to Jesus by night. Let me go pick up in verse 3. The Bible says, Jesus answered and said to him, verily, verily, I say unto you, except a man be born of born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Nicodemus said to him, how can a man be born when he is old? How can he enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born? And Jesus answered and said, verily, I say unto thee, except the man be born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. Verse 6, he says, that which is born of flesh is flesh, and that which is born of spirit is spirit. Marvel not, I say unto thee, you must be born again. This is one of the greatest, greatest things Jesus could ever tell anyone. Really the greatest advice he can give anyone. Really the greatest command he can give anyone. And that is to be born again. We must all be born again. We talked about it all day. We talked about mandates the other day. Mandates, all these mandates going around. This is a mandate. You must be born again. To go to the kingdom of God, to make it to heaven, you must have a change and a born again experience in your life. Again today, it's nothing to shame to be called a born again. Worried with pride. Yes, I've been born again. Thank God I was born again. Nicodemus thought, he says, well, how can I be born again? All these religious books and all these things that he had read, educated man, scholar that he was, he missed the spiritual. The Bible says, Jesus went on to him, he says, you understand earthly things, but you can't understand spiritual things. Many times people's problem, they understand the world, but they can't understand the things of God. And we pray that men and women open up their eyes that we can understand the things of God. And so Jesus began to go on, and he gave a prophecy also about how he was going to be crucified. Let's go to verse 14. 3:14, the Bible gave a prophecy about how he was going to be crucified. This is what it says here. Moses lift up the serpent in the wilderness, even so the Son of Man must be lifted up. He said, whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have eternal life. And so Jesus gave an illustration about Moses. The people were out in the wilderness. They were sinning. They were fornicating, adultery, worshiping false gods. The Bible says God sent forth serpents to bite the people, and they would die right there in the wilderness. The Bible says, but when Moses lifted up the serpent, a brazen serpent that he had him construct, he lifted it up. The Bible says, and when they looked at it, they would be healed. And so Jesus used this many times. He would use these things to ring a bell in their minds. He would use parallels and illustrations to so they could understand on their level. And so they, because all they knew was the laws of Moses. That's all they knew was Moses, and the prophets. And so Jesus would intertwine again him and really trying to show him that he was the Christ through these stories. The Bible says, and whosoever believeth in me shall not perish but have eternal life. Verse 16, for God so loved the world, he sent not his. For God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes on him should not perish but have everlasting life. And so what I said before, the most probably quoted scripture in the whole world is John 3:16. And so he told us the whole purpose was God sending his only begotten. And so whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have eternal life. Verse 17 is key. He says, but for God sent not his Son to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. So Jesus didn't come to condemn. They already knew they was lost. They already knew that they were sinners. Most of them, the religious crowd, they thought they were high and holy. But again, those that were lost, they didn't really need a whole lot of convincing. They already knew their lives were messed up. And many times, that's the way it is in life. Again, you get some real sincere people that know how they are. It's something you got to preach to them. They already know. They already ready. They already made up their mind on the way to the church. This is my night. That's how it was for me. I made up in my mind. This is my night. I'm going to get saved tonight. And why? Because condemnation already spoke to them. Condemnation already dealt with their hearts. Condemnation caused them to want to come and make things right with God. So Jesus didn't come to condemn them. He said, but that they might be saved. Verse 18, he says, he that believeth on him is not condemned, but he that believeth not is condemned already, because he had not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. And so the condemnation comes when we reject Christ. The condemnation comes when we have to stand before God and we rejected him and said no to God. My friend today, say yes to Jesus tonight. Say yes to the Lord. Give him your life tonight. And verse 20 goes on and says, for everyone that doeth evil, 19, excuse me. He said, and this is the condemnation, that the light cometh into the world. This is the condemnation. And what condemns a man? He said, light is coming to the world, and men love darkness more or rather than light. So men love darkness. That's the condemnation. Man wanted sin versus Jesus. Man wants evil versus the good. Man wants to do his own thing and live how he wants to live instead of living a life for Christ unto righteousness. The Bible says, because their deeds were evil, he says, that's the reason why condemnation is upon them. The Bible goes on to say in verse 20, for everyone that doeth evil hateth the light. And that's really a bold statement. And there's really no in-betweens in that. He says, if you reject me, if you do evil, he says, you hate light. You hate me, is what he basically was saying. You're hurting me and you're hurting yourself at the same time. He says, neither coming to the light, at least his deeds should be reproved. So when we come to the light, God makes corrections. We're exposed. And God, you say, God will clean me up. And God exposes our sin and he makes us whole. Amen. Thank God for that. Number 21, it goes on and says, he that doeth truth cometh to light, and that his deeds may be made manifest, that they are wrought in God. And so that was wrapping up what he was speaking to him about, the born again experience, coming to the light, changing, letting Christ transform. The Bible says, them that in Christ are new creatures. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things become new. He says also how he transforms, a renewing of the mind. The born again experience is a renewing of the mind. It's a change of heart. Now you see sin differently. Before, we wanted sin for our own fleshly pleasures. But now that we're in the spirit, we should be in the spirit when you come to Christ. Again, you want to do the things of the spirit and not the things of the flesh. We have to come back to that when we cover Galatians. Look at this. John chapter 3:30. The Bible also says here. So John the Baptist was out there preaching. He was preaching, in the meantime, preaching. And now the time was, now his ministry was now about to come to an end because now Jesus was on the scene. And I like what he said. I just want to bring this one verse up. He says, he must increase, but I must decrease. John said, you know, it's time for me to step away. Because John had many followers, many believed on the gospel. Again, in the preaching of repentance that John had preached. But now Jesus was there. And so now he had to step out of the way and let Jesus take over. And so now he said, I must decrease. And so the same way as our lives, we must decrease. Our own wills, our own ways. God, help me to humble myself. And God, allow your will to be done in my life. Let that all be our prayer. God, let me do for your kingdom. Let me do your will. Let me decrease in what I want to do. Let me increase in you. John chapter four covers about a woman Jesus had met. The ministry began. Jesus had met this woman at the well. And so it's very accurate to say before there are miracles and there are stories and there are controversies going forward, again, that Jesus would do. And so this woman at the well he met, this woman had a troublesome past. She had been married 5 times. And now the man she was with now, she wasn't even married to. And so her life was a mess at the time. But again, Jesus shows us how Jesus is willing to save anybody. The Bible says he met this woman at the well. Divine appointment. He met her at the well, and the Bible says in verse 13, let's pick up verse 13, and she was there looking for water. She was there naturally to get the earthly water. But listen to what Jesus said. He said unto her, whosoever drinketh this water shall never thirst again. I shall thirst again, meaning the natural water that she was trying to get, she was going to thirst again. But the Bible says, but whosoever drinketh of the water that I shall give him shall never thirst again. He says, but the water that I shall give him shall be in him a well of water springing up into everlasting life. Jesus told her about a water that was going to satisfy the soul. And that's what salvation does. That's what the born again experience does. That's what the Holy Spirit does. It satisfies that thirsting and that longing. Many times, again, a man and a woman who's lost in sin, they constantly grappling, looking for a new high, new thing. Why? Because they can't, it won't fulfill. It was no, they looking for the next part or the next thing. Why? To get that emptiness that they're looking for. The next rendezvous, the next boyfriend, the next girlfriend, the next this, that, and the other. My friend is found in Jesus tonight. He says, you'll never thirst again. She probably thought the first husband was going to be good. The second husband going, nah, it was the second husband. Third husband, fourth husband, nope, fifth husband. This woman had 5 husbands. And all of them, every relationship was messed up until she met Jesus. And so Jesus can fix it. Jesus showed her a reality. Naturally, perhaps most men probably try to flirt with the woman because they know she had been around. But Jesus didn't flirt with her. He didn't try to hit on her, but he gave her the truth. Men out there, don't flirt with those ladies. Hey, amen. If you're going to invite them, don't try to get them in bed. We say many times, don't invite them to bed. Invite them to church. How's that? Don't invite them to bed, but invite them to church. Same way with you ladies. Don't try to pull the men in. Get them to church. Amen. Invite them to church. They start flirting with you. Say, hey, what's your phone number? Give them a church card and give them my phone number. That'll give them a nice surprise. But again, you think about it. Bring them into the house of the Lord. And so Jesus didn't flirt with her. He gave her the truth. Let's go to John 4:23. He said, the hour cometh. He said, but now is the true worshipers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For the Father seeketh such to worship him. Number 24, God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. And so we see the reality. He wasn't a regular man. He wasn't some hypocrite. He was real. He wasn't trying to flirt with this lady. He was telling her the truth. So he was thinking about her soul and not her flesh. Does everybody follow? And so from this point on, the story goes, she became a soul winner. Let's go to verse 4:28 and 29. She became a soul winner. When you get saved, you become a soul winner. You want to win somebody. You want to bring somebody. This is what it says. The woman left her water pots. She was at the well. She left her water pots, the Bible says, and went her way into the city and said unto him, come see a man who would tell me all things that ever I did. Is not this the Christ? She says, come and see a man. She forgot the water pots. She ran back into the city and got the whole city to come out there where Jesus was at the well. The Bible says all these people came out there and they heard him speak. And then the Bible says later on, I didn't write it down here, but later on they said, you know what? We believe also. Not for what she said, but we believe it for ourselves. We preach for men sometimes about they believed it for themselves. You got to believe it for yourself. You got to believe it within your heart. You can't go off of mama's relationship. You can't go off of daddy's relationship with God. You can't go off of granddaddy's relationship. You got to serve God for yourself. Amen. And so the next few chapters go on about Jesus healing the lame. He healed the lame on the Sabbath day. And back to what I said before, all these miracles will come conflict. And so the religious bunch, they got mad at him because he healed on the Sabbath day. They should have been happy. But again, he was doing the work of God. So if you get mad at me for healing on the Sabbath day, again, you mad, not mad at Jesus. You was mad at the Father because the Father sent him to do the work. That's what he told them. Again, they were always getting mad. They got mad at him for claiming to be the Son of God. He says, my Father, when he said, my Father sent me to do this, I'm doing the work of my Father, they even got more angry because that means, and they declared, say, oh, that means you're saying you're equal with God. So there is again, they knew. The Pharisees and Sadducees, they knew when you claim to be the Son of God, the coming of Christ, the Son of God, that meant you was equal with God. And they said, you claim to be the equal with God. And so they got even more mad and angry and upset. Why? Because again, of what the prophecies have said, how that the Bible says that the Son of God, again, how he would come. And so they got even more upset. Chapter 6 covers the feeding of 5,000. And during this feeding of 5,000, again, more miracles, but more problems would come for the unbeliever. But he told him during this time of miracles, of feeding the 5,000, he told him he is the bread of life as well. Jesus is the bread of life. So John declares him as the bread of life. I wrote that down. He put that in there as the bread of life. But again, many would get offended by him by saying this. Chapter 7 through 10, more proclamations about being the light of the world. More proclamations about those that were thirsty, let them come and drink of him. And so again, as the more he proclaimed, the more he preached and taught, the more they got upset. And that's just like the devil. The more you preach and teach and no doubt do work for God, the devil's getting more and more upset, but we got to continue to do it. Chapter 8 was another story about the woman who got caught in adultery. It's another story about the woman who got caught in adultery. And naturally, this was a horrendous crime. And so, again, adultery, again, if the enemy's trying to put that in your heart to go cheat on your spouse, in the name of Jesus, we rebuke in the name of Jesus. Pray through, get right with God. Again, today, get that, shake it off, and again, today, make things right with God. So, again, in those days, the law was to stone that person for being caught in adultery. This woman was caught in the very act. Bible says here, and so they brought this woman to Jesus. They're trying to catch him. They're trying to set Jesus up. Again, today, because of all that he was doing, he was causing an uproar, and they got real jealous. And so the religious crowd, those that were following the Torah, and those so-called the crowd that knew the laws of Moses in and out, they brought this woman to Jesus to see what he would do, since he claimed to be the Son of God. Let's look what it says in verse 5. Now Moses in the law commanded us that she should be stoned. He says, what do you say? Number 6, he says, and this they said, tempting him, that they might have to accuse him. But Jesus stooped down with his finger and wrote on the ground as though he heard them not. Sometimes you got to ignore fault finders. Ignore fault finders. Sometimes you got to ignore fault finders. I'm going to say it again. Ignore, block stuff out. Some things don't even entertain. Don't entertain the devil. Don't entertain people who talk and talk and talk and talk. And whatever they're trying to get at you, ignore them. Jesus ignored them. The Bible says in verse 7, and so when he continued asking him, he lifted up himself and said, he that is without sin among you, let him first cast a stone at her. And so he hit him right in the heart. He says, anybody here, if you got no sin, all right, you justify to throw a stone at this woman. Remember I told you a few weeks ago, I said, I got one pointing finger at you, but I got three pointing back at me. Again today. And so he says, you know what? You need to check your heart. Guard your heart. Make sure you're living a life before you try to find fault with everybody else. Everybody follow that. And so let's look at this. He said, he does without sin, let him cast the first stone. Number 8, he went on and says, and again, he stooped down and rolled on the ground. Number 9, and when they heard this, they were convinced by their own conscience, convicted by their own conscience, excuse me. He says, and went out one by one, being the eldest, even unto the least. And Jesus left alone. And the woman standing in the midst. So everybody, all the accusers left. And they dropped their rocks. They dropped them all right down the ground. Number 10, he goes on. And when Jesus lifted himself up and none saw none but the woman, he said unto her, woman, where are thine accusers? Hath no man condemned thee? And she said, no man, Lord. And Jesus said unto her, neither do I condemn thee. Go and sin no more. So he didn't just tell her to go and be about your life. He says, go and sin no more. In other words, repent. Get things right with God. And don't go back and do it again. That's the same thing with our lives. In any sin, no doubt, perhaps, again, go repent. Go repent. Don't go back to it again. That's what repentance is, to not go back to it again. Don't pick that thing back up. Ask God to deliver you from it. Ask God to cleanse you from it and walk away. God help me. Amen. Along the way. And that's what he told her. He says, go and sin no more. He gave her the authority to say no to that thing ever again in her life. Number 12, it goes on. It says, and then spake Jesus unto them, saying, I am the light of the world. There it is again. I am the light of the world. He that followeth me shall not walk in darkness, but shall have light, have the light of life. And so he's telling them to come out of darkness. Come out of darkness and come on and follow me. When you follow Jesus, you don't want to live in darkness. When you follow Jesus, you don't want to live in darkness. Again, today, when you follow Jesus, the conviction will come saying, you know what? I don't think I should be in this place. I shouldn't be in this predicament. I shouldn't be thinking like this. I shouldn't be saying these things. Why? Because I'm a follower of Christ. Does everybody follow that? Number 10, chapter 10. I'm going to get through this, guys. We almost there. The Bible says here how that Jesus, he continued to proclaim himself, give proclamation of who he was. He was the light of the world. He was the living water. He also said here in this one about how he's a sheep. The Bible says, Jesus said unto him, verily, verily, I say unto you, I am the door of the sheep, or the shepherd. He says, all they ever come before me are thieves and robbers. He says, but the sheep did not hear them. I am the door. By me, if any man enter in, he shall be saved. Number 9. This is 10:9. John 10:9. He said, I am the door. By me, if any man may enter in, he shall be saved and shall go in and out and find pasture. He will go in and out and find pasture. He went on to say, the thief coming not but to steal, to kill, and to destroy. But I am come that they may have life and that they may have it more abundantly. He was letting them know he is a shepherd. Again, the Lord is my shepherd, is what David wrote. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not walk. And so he gives them green pastures. You come in and get blessed. You come in and find what you need. He takes care of us. He loves us. He said the rest are thieves and robbers. The devil will try to steal, kill, and destroy, is what he said in verses 10. He will steal, kill, and destroy. That's what he ultimately does. He robs us. He will try to rob you of your joy, rob you of your childhood, rob you of your peace, rob you of your sanity. The devil will try to rob you of everything, again, that God wants for your life. Today, cut your ties with the enemy. Kick the devil out and serve the Lord. He said, I'm going to give you life in that more abundantly. Number 11, it goes on and says, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd giveth his life for his sheep. So again, he was willing to give his life for the sheep, for the people, the followers of Christ. Then Christians are considered sheep. Some may see, are you none but a sheep? Yes, that's a good term. I'm a sheep. I'm a follower of Christ. And you know what? In your heart, your soul, wear it as a badge. Yes, I'm a sheeple. Yes, 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 I am. I want to be a follower of Christ. He's my shepherd. The Bible goes on and says, number 12, he says, but he that is a hireling is not the shepherd, whose own sheep are not. He says, seeth the wolf coming and leaveth the sheep and fleeth. And the wolf catcheth them and scattereth the sheep. 13, he says, the hireling fleeth because he is a hireling and careth not for the sheep. I am the good shepherd and know my sheep and am known of mine. And so we know him and he knows us. And he's talking about the hireling being there's some shepherds that don't care about you. They don't care about your soul. They don't care about your well-being. They don't care what you, how you end up or how your well-being may be. But Jesus cares for you. And we endeavor to care for you as a pastor. Lord, help us to continue to care for each one of you. If you have a need, hey, we're here for you. All right. All right. And so chapter 11 talks about the miracle of Lazarus. One of the final miracles that Jesus had done leading up to the crucifixion was the miracle of Lazarus. Lazarus was a friend of Jesus. He loved Lazarus. The Bible says Jesus wept. He cried because when he found out Lazarus was dead, he was sick at first and time went on. He was in a whole different city. He waited and Lazarus died. Perhaps he could have easily ran over there and healed him while he was still alive, but he wanted to really have a grand finale of miracles. And so the miracle of Lazarus is raising up. Let's go to 11:25. Jesus, so Lazarus had died, and so Mary and Martha had come up and ran up to Jesus and said, hey, our brother's dead now. If he had been here, he would not have died. And then he said, no, he's not there. He's just sleeping. And then she went on and says, you know what? We know he will see him again. And Jesus said, no, no, no. he began to, this famous verse of scripture here in verse 25. Listen to what it says. He says, he said, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth on me, though he were dead, yet shall live. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. He says, believest thou this? And she said to him, yea, Lord, I believe that thou art the Christ, the Son of God, which should come into the world. And so when he says you shall never die, we covered this Sunday morning. We made a statement about the second death. And yes, we will physically die. Barring the rapture of the church, we will die. We will die. One day we will. But the second death is, in other words, when you die, the first death, when you die, it's just his body. The soul lives on forever. But the second death in Revelation, the Bible says, you will be cast into the lake of fire, which is the second death. The non-believer, the sinner and the devil and all of his angels and all the non-believers that reject Christ will be have the second death, which is the lake of fire. And so the Bible says today, that's what he means by you should never die. You should never die. In other words, you will live eternally with Jesus Christ. And really, that's what your ultimate goal is to live for Christ. Chapter 12 goes on and tells us about the crucifixion of Jesus Christ. Let's go to 12, 23 through 32. I'm going to get through all this. These Bible studies are a bit longer because it's a lot of here. The rest of them should be shorter, but I got to get through all this to finish up. We hope in 1 year. Let's go. The Bible says here, and Jesus said to him, the hour has come that the Son of Man should be glorified. So Jesus knew the time was coming when he was about to die. What the whole purpose of him coming to the earth. The Bible says, verily I say unto you, except a corn of wheat fall into the ground and die, it abideth alone. But if it die, it bringeth forth much fruit. And so we see this. If you have seeds, those out there, you have seeds, perhaps in a package somewhere, or you have seeds in an apple or a watermelon, whatever it may be. That seed is just a seed, but until it goes into the ground and dies, it'll never, ever, ever produce more apples or more watermelons or more whatever, you know, more flowers. It'll never do it until that seed is planted and put in the ground and dies. That seed has to give up. It has to open up. It has to be yielded and penetrated. And as it does, it's the same way in our heart. That shell that we have has to be opened up. That old hardened shell of our souls, we have to open up and say, God, come into my life. And when we do this, we'll become fruitful. And Jesus had to do the same thing. Jesus had to die so the fruit of his life could be made known, which is the Christians, the believers in Christ, the fruit, the church would now begin to flourish through his death. And so let's look at some more here. The Bible says in 25, he that loveth his life shall lose it. But he that hateth his life in this world shall keep it unto eternal life. So play on words there. If you hate your life, in other words, you despise your past, you're pushing away your past. Meaning, when you hate your life, it means you push away your past. I despise the way I used to be. I despise sin. I despise the wicked ways, the wicked man I used to be. And so I hate that life. I'm changing through the born again experience. He says, you shall find life through the born again experience. But if you keep your life, you're going to lose it. So you say, you know, I'm not changing, preacher. I'm going to die. I was born this way. I'm going to die this way. I'm going to live the life. Ain't nobody going to tell me what to do. I'm going to live how I want to live, how I want to do it. Live the life how I want to. Ain't no preacher going to tell me what to do. Ain't no church going to tell me what to do. I'm going to do what I want to do my life myself. Okay. You're going to lose your life. You'll lose your soul. My friend, they let the Lord change your thinking. Be like that seed that's broken. Be like that shell and say, God, I open up to you. Let's move on. So 26, he says, if any man serve me, let him follow me. Where I am, there I shall also my servant be. If any man serve me, him will my Father honor. So again, you serve me. If the Father sees up in heaven. God is writing it all down. God is writing down everything we think, everything we say, everything we do. He's writing it all down. We want to let our lives honor Christ. But number 27, excuse me. Now is my soul troubled. This is Jesus praying. He's praying. He knew he was about to die. He said, now my soul is troubled. What shall I say? Father, save me from this hour. He says, but for this cause came I into this hour. And so he began to, the natural side of Christ began to kick in. He began to get wishy-washy. He said, Lord, if I can get out of this, please step in now, Heavenly Father. But you know, he snapped back. Through prayer, you snap back into place and say, you know what? My thinking's not right. My heart's not right. So Jesus had to slap himself back into place through prayer and say, you know, I got to go through with this. And the Bible goes on and says, 28, Father, glorify thy name. Then came there a voice from heaven saying, I have both glorified it and glorified it again. That's the Father speaking. 29, he says, and the people therefore that stood by heard it, said that it thundered. Others said the angels spake to him. And Jesus answered verse 30 and said to them, the voice came not because of me, but for your sake. The Father spoke to them to let the world know, those that were seeing and hearing, let them know this thing was real. He was real. He was truly the Son of God. And heaven spoke down. Again, the Father spoke from heaven. The Bible says here in 31, this is the judgment of this world. Now is the judgment of this world. Now shall the prince of the world be cast out. And I, if I be lifted up from the earth, will draw all men unto me. So now, he says, now, you know, this thing is about to go down. I'm about to be lifted up on this cross. But as I'm lifted up on the cross, men will see. Men will come. Men will believe in me. This is the purpose of me coming. Just like Moses and that serpent, they will see and know. And no doubt find healing for the soul, find healing for their minds, find healing for their lives. Chapters 13 through 17, we got to get out of this, through this book. 13 through 17 is the final events of Christ. We've covered this for the past few weeks, the final events of the crucifixion, death, burial, and resurrections, and really some words before Christ was going to be crucified. Let's go to 13, 6 through 9. I'm not going to cover it all. This is an occasion when Jesus was washing the feet of the disciples. Jesus now, again, was preparing his disciples and teaching his disciples and preparing their hearts for what was about to happen. And so he came, brought them all into the room, started washing their feet. And it's really it's a sign of humility for the King of Kings to bow down and wash the disciples' feet. A sign of humility. That shows that he was not only king, but he was humble at the same time. Number six, he tells us, then cometh he to Simon Peter. It's time for Peter's feet to get washed. The Bible says, and Peter said to him, Lord, dost not thou wash my feet? And Jesus said unto him, answered and said unto him, What I do, thou knowest not now. He says, but thou shalt not know hereafter. Number 8. And Peter said unto him, thou shalt never wash my feet. Jesus answered him, if I wash not thee not, thou hast no part of me. And so Peter said, no, you're not gonna wash my feet. In other words, it was a play of humility plus just Peter being Peter. How's that? He really didn't fully understand the whole purpose of it all. But when he told him, he said, hey, if you don't let me wash your feet, you will have no part of me. Listen how Peter's response was. Simon Peter said to him, Lord, not my feet only, but also my hands and my head. God, just not knowing my feet. Wash my feet for my path that I'm going to take. Wash my hands, Lord, from anything I've done wrong. Wash my hands from any ill will. And bless me with my hands. Bless my work, God, that I'm about to do. Not only that, but wash my thoughts. And Peter said, wash me clean, God. Head to toe, God, clean me up. God, I want to go to heaven. And you know what? In your life, the same thing. Lord, cleanse us. Make us whole from top of the head to our soles of our feet. And so John chapter 13, 6, 36, more teaching and more information about him about to die. That's what he says here. Simon Peter said to him, Lord, whither thou goest? So Jesus told him he was leaving. And Jesus said to him, whither I go, thou canst not follow me now. He said, well, I'm about to go. You can't follow me right now. He says, but thou shalt follow me afterwards. He says, and Peter said to him, Lord, why can I not follow thee? I will lay down my life for thy sake. And Jesus said to him, wilt thou lay down thy life for my sake? Verily, I say unto thee, the cock shall not crow till thou hast denied me three times. That's an infamous time where when Jesus was being carried away, the cock would crow three times. When Peter was asked, do you know him? Do you know him? Are you one of the associates of Christ? And he said, no, three times. And so that's when Jesus told him what was going to happen. And so a little bit later on down the line, I'm going to get through all of this, folks, I promise. John 14, Jesus began to, naturally the disciples began to get uneasy. The people that were hearing this began to get uneasy. And I like what he said in verse 1. The Bible says 14:1, let not your heart be troubled. When you get uneasy, Remember this verse here. Let not your heart be troubled. He says, believe you in God, believe also in me. And so the words I'm speaking, he says, in my Father's house are many mansions. He says, if it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. Jesus gave them assurance that I'm not going to leave you long, just for a little while. You're going to come with me in heaven one day. It says, and whether I go, ye know, and the way ye know. And Thomas said to him, Lord, we know not whither thou goest. How can we know the way? And Jesus said to him, an infamous verse here. He says, Jesus said to him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. And if ye had known me, ye should have known my Father also. And from hence ye know him and have seen him. And so Jesus, the infamous verse about he is the way, the only way, through is Jesus Christ. It's to, again, there's no other way, no other name. Where can we be saved today? We cannot be saved any other way. It's only through Christ Jesus. And chapter 16, he's leading up to the crucifixion here. In 16:31, the Bible says, Jesus answered, do you now believe? Behold, the hour cometh, yea, now come. And they were all scattered, every man to his own, and shall leave me alone. Yet I am not alone, because my Father is with me. He says here, people are going to leave me. It was about to get really, really turmoil was about to kick in, and the soldiers were about to come in, and all these different things were about to grab Jesus, the one that they were looking up to be the Messiah, to be the king, to come set up the rulership. We're going to be carried away. And the Bible says if they don't, and many will walk away because of this. When trouble comes, don't walk away. When tough, difficult times come, don't throw in the towel and run away. Dig in. Believe. Trust God. Don't bail on your marriage. Don't bail on your family. Don't bail on your belief in God. Don't bail. Dig in and pray through. Get things right with God. Number 33, Bible says, in these things I have spoken unto you, that in me you might have peace. So back to what we're saying, get to God. When you're facing troubles, get to God. Find the peace of God in your heart. Say, you know what? I'm not thinking right now. It's going to get better. It's got to get better. And no doubt to help settle the mind. The Bible goes on and says, in the world, you should have tribulation. It's nothing new. Nobody promised roses and a lily white world. He says, you will face tribulation. You're going to face hard. As long as you have breath in your body, my friend, the devil will fight you all the way to your grave. Write it down. Just because you're born again now, just because you come to Christ, write it down. Jesus said, you're going to have tribulation. You're going to go through some battles, some hard battles. What Jesus said, he didn't promise us a bed of roses. He said, you're going to face tribulation. And many believers, I think sometimes we get blown away when you go through things. He says, you're going to go through some things in your life. He said, but be of good cheer. That's the part I like. Be of good cheer. Rejoice. Get glad. Amen. Rejoice and say, you know what? God's going to work this out. Rejoice. Put a smile on your face. Say, you know what? Thank you, Jesus. I don't know how you're going to work it out, but you're going to work it out. He says, I have overcome the world. And through Jesus Christ, if he overcame the world, we can overcome anything because we trust in him. We know that if he overcame death, he can overcome anything. And if we call upon him, he'll help you overcome in whatever challenge you go through in your life. Chapter 17 is a prayer of Jesus for him. And for the things to come and for his disciples. He prayed for his disciples. God helped them. He said, I'm about to go back into heaven, be back with my Father. He was going back to be back with his Father. But as he's praying to his Heavenly Father, he began to pray for the disciples. Pray for one another. Pray for one another. That he says, help them because they're going to face some great challenges. Thank God he intercedes for us, even now as we speak. Intercede for someone. Pray for someone. Love someone. Chapters 18 and through 20 cover the trial. It talks about Judas betraying Jesus. I'll give you these quickly. I'm going to let you guys go. But 2 through 6, let's look at this real quickly. The Bible says, Judas also, which betrayed him, knew the place, for Jesus often resorted, and therefore with his disciples. So Judas has sold Jesus out, and now he's taking these soldiers to catch Jesus. The Bible says, Judas then, having received a band of men and officers from the chief priests and Pharisees, came to them with lanterns and torches and weapons. Can you imagine this? everyone he walked with and talked with and loved. Now he was coming against Christ. The Bible comes on and says in verse 4, Jesus, therefore, knowing all the things that should have come upon him, he says, went forth and said unto them, whom seek ye? And they answered, Jesus of Nazareth. And Jesus said unto him, I am he. And Judas also, which betrayed him, stood with them. Number 6 is the verse I want to bring. I brought this up because of this. Jesus, as he had said unto them, I am he, they went backwards and fell to the ground. And can you imagine? When he turned and said, I am he, I'm the one you're looking for, all of them fell down. That's the power of God's word, the power of his voice. He could have easily called down angels from heaven and absolutely called down and just wiped all the Roman soldiers and whoever else was in the way out the way. Just his word said, I am he, and they all fell backwards. That's the power of God. I love that verse. But again, I'm not going to go through it all. Chapter 19 talks about how the verses 1 through 6. The Bible says, and 19, 1 through 6. No, I'm going to skip through it. We have run out of time here. And so the Bible says, and so he was led. They captured him. They led him to Pilate. The Bible says, and they took Jesus and scourged him. They scourged him, and the soldiers platted a crown of thorns upon his head and put it in his head, and they put a purple robe on him. It was a mockery of purple means royal. And so they mocked him that way. The Bible went on and says, and they said, all hail King Jesus. He says, and they smote him. In other words, they hit him with his hand and slapped him. And Jesus therefore went again and said to him, behold, I will bring forth to you that they may know that I know fault with him. And then came Jesus forth wearing a crown of thorns, a purple robe. And Pilate said to him, behold the man. He said, and when the chief priest therefore said, and the officers saw him, they cried out, crucify him, crucify him. And Pilate said to him, take ye him. And crucify him, I find no fault in him. He was wiping his hands clean, but they wanted to crucify him. The Bible says in chapter 19, verse 30, and Jesus, they nailed him to the cross. We know the story. Again, they put him on the old rugged cross. The Bible says, and when therefore Jesus had received the vinegar, he said to him, it is finished. And he bowed his head and gave up the ghost. So he died for our sins. The Bible says in verse 32, then came the soldiers and brake his legs. The first and the others were crucified with him, but when they came and they saw Jesus was dead already, they break his legs. 34, and it says, one of the soldiers with a spear pierced his side, and forth went out blood in the water. So again, they pierced him in his side. That's where it comes from. 1940, the Bible says, and then they took the body of Jesus and wound it up with linen clothes and spices as the manner of the Jews to bury him. Now in this place where he was crucified, there was a garden, and in the garden a new sepulchre, wherein never was a man laid, man yet laid. Bible says in 42, and then laid they Jesus, therefore because of the Jews, preparation day for the sepulchre was not at hand. So they put him in that old tomb. 3 days, we're going to cover it next week. For 3 days, he went to hell. For you and I, he went down to the grave and suffered, no doubt. He suffered on the cross, but he went to hell to set the captive free. We'll cover that next week in the book of Acts. And then as we close up, chapter 20, the Bible says, on the first day of the week, cometh Mary Magdalene early when it was yet dark. He says, and when the sepulchre, and seeth the stone taken away from the sepulchre, and she runneth and cometh to Simon and to the other disciples whom Jesus loved, and said unto him, they have taken away the Lord out of the sepulchre. He says, and we know not where they laid him. So it was chaos again. They went to go prepare his body and kind of keep him preserved. But the stone was rolled away. The third day, just like Jesus said, after 3 days, you're going to tear this temple down. But in 3 days, I'll rise again. In verses 15, the Bible says he appeared unto these women. The Bible says he said unto her, woman, why weepest thou? 2015. So pull up 2015 through 17. So Jesus had come to these people. He had come to these women. And he saw her crying. And he says, why are you weeping? He says, whom are you seeking? Supposing him to be the gardener. She thought he was the gardener. Naturally, she still thought he was dead. And somebody had played a dirty trick on him. And the Bible says in verse 16, Jesus said, Mary. And she turned herself and said, Rabboni, which is to say master. And so verse 17. And Jesus said unto her, touch me not. He says, for I am not yet ascended to my Father, but go to my brethren and say unto them, I ascended unto my Father and your Father, my God and your God. 17. That's 17. So he says, go get everybody, go tell them. I'm about to go back to my father. I'm alive, I'm alive, I'm alive. And that, no doubt, he was truly alive. You also read about Doubting Thomas, how he, in chapter 20, how he wanted to see it for himself. He had heard rumors, but he said, Lord, except I put my finger in your hand in my side. That's chapter 20. Go back and read the rest of chapter 20. I'm not going to cover. I got one more minute. And so he says, I'm not going to, I won't believe until then. But you know what? We gotta pull up that verse. 28. So Thomas put his finger in the Lord's side. John 20:28. He says, my Lord, my God. In other words, he says, he's my Lord and my God. He realized he was alive. And in chapter 21, let's just go ahead and go through it. Chapter 21, in closing, Jesus gave them final instructions. 21, John 21:14. He gave them final instructions about how he was about to go and what they were to do. And this is what he says, and I close out with these. And now the third time that Jesus showed himself to his disciples, after that he was risen from the dead. So when they had dined, Jesus said to Simon Peter, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me more than these? He said, yea, Lord. He says, thou knowest that I lovest thee. He said unto him, feed my lambs. This was a commandment. He was really testing Peter's heart about fishing and going back to the way they used to be. And he was asking, he said, do you love me more than these? Do you love me more than anything else? I need you to go and preach my word. Peter was going to be the first one to preach the gospel, preach the first message there in the book of Acts. And so he was really, really passing the mantle on to Peter. The Bible says in verse 16, when he said unto him again the second time, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me? He says, yea, Lord, thou knowest I lovest thee. He said unto him, feed my sheep. And he said unto him a third time, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me? And Peter was grieved because he had said unto him a third time, lovest thou me? He said unto him, Lord, thou knowest all things. Thou knowest that I love thee. Jesus said unto him, feed my sheep. He was commissioning him to go and preach the word. And I look back over it, I say, you know, why did he ask him three times? Perhaps because Peter had denied him three times. Remember, three times before, Peter had denied Jesus three times. When they asked him, was he one of the disciples? He denied him three times. So perhaps Jesus was reversing the denial to make sure that he was ready. And in verses 24 and 25, as we close, last ones, the Bible says, John, he wrote this. John, just like I can go all night long. Imagine me, I've gone on for an hour enough. Please forgive me, folks. We got to get through these Bible studies. John had wrote a profound statement. He says, just like we get long-winded as a preacher, he can get long-winded with his writing. This is what he says, you know. This is the disciples have testified these things and wrote these things. And we know that his testimony is true. So John was confirming the testimony of the Lord. And there are many other things which Jesus did, the which, if it were to be written, everyone, I suppose, that even the world itself cannot contain the books that are written. Amen. And that's how John ended. He says, there is so much more I can write. There's so much more I can say tonight. I just skimmed over this book, and it took me an hour to do it. But you think about it, there was so much more that Jesus had done. There are so many more writings and historical writings that got lost. There are so many more historical writings that historians have that the Romans destroyed, letters and the government. Why Satan wanted these books destroyed? So many more testimonies of witnesses, accounts of what Jesus had done for them individually. There are so many books and references beyond the Bible of who God is. And so, again, he says there's so much more that the Lord could have written. But again, here today is a synopsis of what Christ has done. That's how awesome the God is. There's not enough server space, we say, in the 21st century. There's not enough gigabytes, megabytes, trigabytes. There's not enough paper and ink and pencils and trees enough to make enough paper to write what all God is. That's how big our God is. Tonight, we hope you got something out of the book of John. Again, it's an awesome book. Go back and read it for yourself. I just skimmed over some of the highlights. And again, God bless you, is our prayer. We look forward to seeing you this Thursday night in person at the church, 334 Aspen Street. Bring a friend. Bring somebody this weekend with you, this Sunday morning at 11 a.m. as well. Come on out and be with us. And we say, again, continue thanking you for your donations. support the work of the Lord. Support the work of the Lord. And again, watch God truly bless you. Again, today, God bless you. Have a wonderful evening.